Hi, Edge families, and welcome back to our third Edge at Home. Today, Mary is actually going to be giving the proclaim. She works with a seventh grade girls small group, and I'm super excited for you guys to hear all about it. Before we get to that, I just wanted to do some quick announcements before we start. So as you know, Holy Week is coming up, and I recommend you to make sure you're on Eleanor's, our Director of Religious Education here at St. Thomas Aquinas, her email list. She's been sending out a lot of really good information about the upcoming Holy Week with the precautions and on all the changes that are being taken because of the coronavirus. I also am excited to announce that we're starting a new program called Prayer Pals. If you're interested, please reach out to me. The program is designed to connect a middle schooler with a college student at UVA in a letter writing initiative, kind of like a pen pal. So if you're interested, please reach out to me and we can get you started with that. And finally, on this Sunday at 4 p.m., we'll be having our Edge virtual office hours, and I look forward to seeing as many of you there as possible. Thanks, I hope you enjoy the proclaim.
Hello, everyone. My name is Mary Woloski, and I am to present this evening's Edge topic on rest. It will address death and grief. But before we begin, there are some supplies you need to gather for this lesson. You'll need your Bible, some paper for everyone, a pen or a pencil, a candle and a lighter, and also if you can gather together and put aside some celebratory items such as cake, cupcakes, snacks, peanuts, popcorn, some balloons if you have, and any uplifting Christian music. Just gather those and put them aside. Pause the video as you go about gathering your supplies. The goal of the lesson is to understand loss and grief in the light of resurrection and hope for heaven, and to understand that God's love is always near. This week we're going to be talking about how to deal with death in the light of our faith. We're going to be looking at two scripture readings, one where Jesus himself wept, and a second that tells us how he dealt with grief. It is important to remember that Jesus already won the battle. He's won the victory, and death is not the end. But that does not mean that it is not still hard for family members to be left behind. We can be assured that God himself knows our hearts and our deepest desires for our family members. Let us begin with prayer. Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in them the fire of your love. Send forth your Spirit, and they shall be created, and you shall renew the face of the earth. O God, who by the light of the Holy Spirit did instruct the hearts of the faithful, grant that by the same Holy Spirit we may be truly wise and ever enjoy his consolations. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Okay, so please open your Bibles to John chapter 11 and read aloud verses 1 to 44. Pay attention to any part of the story that stands out to you. Then, when finished reading, take a few moments of silence and look over the passage a second time. Pause the video as you do this activity. Now that you've read all the passage of John chapter 11, here are some discussion questions. I'd like you to go through them one at a time and discuss them amongst yourself. Pause the video as you do this. It is hard not to wonder why bad things happen to good people, especially if we've ever seen anyone suffering from a terminal illness. We may wonder and ask, why God? In order to understand why God would allow people to suffer, it is important to remember that we live in a fallen world. When God created the world, he created humanity in perfect harmony with himself, nature, and others. He also created humanity with the ability to choose right from wrong. This ability to make our own choices, also called free will, is what led to the world-altering decision made by Adam and Eve. Adam and Eve freely chose to do the one thing that God asked them not to do. This was an action that showed distrust of God and His goodness. This was an act of disobedience to what God had told them. This was the first sin. From this point on, suffering, death, and sin entered the world. Humanity was no longer in harmony with God, itself, nature, or each other. It is important to note, though, when someone is suffering from illness, it is not a result of his or her sin. It is just the state of the fallen world that we live in and a part of our lives. But God does not simply leave us to suffer. Rather, He sent Jesus Christ, who died for our sins, and repaired our relationship with God that was broken by the sin that Adam and Eve committed. When Jesus died, He freed us from the slavery of sin. When He rose from the dead, He overcame death itself. When Jesus died, He opened for us all the gates of heaven for all the holy and righteous to enter into eternal happiness. This means that we can find hope in knowing that death is not the end, and we may one day see our beloved ones again in heaven. God is a merciful God. Recall last week's teaching on judgment in heaven, hell, and purgatory. In God's great mercy, we can hope for our loved ones to make it to heaven. But it is also important that we pray for them. Let us remember those who have passed away. Each of you take a piece of paper and at the top of the paper, write the name of one deceased person that you know who has passed away. All gathered here can participate in this activity. Now, light a candle and think of that person. Pause the video if you need to do this activity. Now I'd like you to reflect on these questions and write your answer down under the person's name on that piece of paper in front of you. Your favorite memory of them, what you liked most about them, what bothered you the most when they passed away, and if there is anything you can say to Jesus about this person or the loss of this person, what would it be? Pause the video once you've done this, and also, once completed, share your answers with one another. Pause the video. We can trust in God's loving mercy and hope to be united with all our loved ones again in heaven. Let us never forget those who've passed away and continue to pray for their souls. Let us pray together out loud and insert the name of a deceased person in the blank. Dear Lord Jesus, I entrust to you the soul of, and I ask you to show great mercy on our loved ones and welcome them into your eternal kingdom. May they experience the goodness of your love with joy as they meet you face to face. And may we one day too join them all in heaven. Amen. I will say the first sentence and I would like you all to respond by saying the response. Eternal rest grant unto them, O Lord. One of the most beautiful things about our Catholic faith is that we form one family in communion with all those who are part of the Church here on earth, all those who are in purgatory, and all the souls in heaven. We are never really apart from the ones that we love who passed away, and we can find particular closeness with them in the Holy Mass. While it is very hard to have people we love die, it is important to remember that it is just the end of their earthly bodies. But our souls will never die. They are immortal. Death is not the end, but rather it is the beginning of our eternal life with God. I have lost my sister, nephew, mother, and more recently my father. My sister's death was the most difficult for me. She was 1.5 years younger than I, and it has been 11 years since she passed. I still miss her and all the members of my family. Let us pray once more. God, our Father, your power brings us to birth, your providence guides our lives, and by your command we pass away. Lord, those who die still live in your presence. Their lives change but do not end. I pray and hope for my family, relatives and friends, and for all the dead known to you alone. In the company with Christ, who died and now lives, may they rejoice in your kingdom, where all our tears are wiped away. Unite us together again in one family to sing your praise forever and ever. Amen. Even though Jesus is our all-powerful God who has power over life and death and knows that death is not the end, he still experienced grief at the death of his friends. We have to remember, even though Jesus was God, he was also fully man and experienced emotions. We saw in the scripture verse at the beginning of Edge night when he wept at the death of Lazarus. After his cousin John the Baptist is killed, Jesus retreats to be alone and process what happened. Not only did Jesus experience grief at the loss of his friends, he also experienced great suffering, loneliness, fear, and sorrow, knowing what his own death will entail. Now, if you can open your Bibles and read Matthew chapter 26, verses 36 to 38. Someone could read it aloud. Pause the video as you do this activity. Jesus himself felt abandoned, alone in the Garden of Gethsemane. His friends fell asleep when he needed them the most, and later fled entirely when he was arrested. He was God, and he experienced this pain of loneliness, so he knows what it is like to feel lonely. Grief can often make us feel alone and abandoned. However, God never leaves us. We have to have faith and hope in Christ that he will not abandon us in our sadness. In your grief, do not run from God, but run to God. He can handle your grief. He knows how it feels to grieve and how it feels to lose loved ones, and he can help you through your grief. Find comfort knowing that he never leaves you. There are some things that you can do both physically and spiritually to cope with grief. Attend your loved one's funeral. Pray for your loved one. Talk to your parents about having a mass said for him or her. And a good way to cope with grief and to remember your loved one is to keep a journal of your favorite memories. Make a memory box with photos or keepsakes. Light a candle at church for this person. And remember dates of birth, death, and other special occasions. Remember, too, if you are really struggling with grief or depression, you are not alone, and there are a lot of people who can help you. You can reach out to one of our core members or youth minister to help point you in the right direction to someone who can help you through this difficult time. Speak with your parents. Also, you can speak with our parish priest. If you have a friend who is grieving, make sure to be patient with them and encourage them. It is important to reach out to them because they are going through a really hard time. Be sensitive and supportive around holidays that are really difficult the first year following a death. You, as their friend, can bring the love of Jesus to them when they need it most. Do not be shy to use the name of the person who died or to ask to see photos and hear stories. And once again, it is important to pray for the dead. Our Christian church, from its earliest days, has honored with great respect the memory of the dead. It is a holy, wholesome thought to pray for the dead, that they be released of their sins. Our prayer for them is capable not only of helping them, but also of making their intercession for us effective. So let us close with a prayer of thanksgiving, and let us all say this together. God, we thank you for the gift of life and of all our loved ones that are here with us on earth, and especially for those who have passed. Amen. This concludes our lesson, and now for the celebration of life. Enjoy. I'll play some